am considering taking Tesla private at 420, funding secured. The SEC disputed that claim and charged him with securities fraud. The case was settled with Musk agreeing that his communications relating to the company, including Twitter, would be overseen by his board. Have you had any of your tweets censored since the settlement?
No.
None. Does someone have to read them before they go out?
No.
So your tweets are not supervised?
The only tweets that would have to be, say, reviewed would be if a tweet had a probability of causing a movement in the stock.
And that's it?
Yeah, I mean, otherwise it's, hello, First Amendment. It's free, like, freedom of speech is fundamental.
But how do they know if it's going to move the market if they're not reading all of them before you send them?
Well, I guess we might make some mistakes. Who knows?
Are you serious?
Nobody's perfect.
Look at you.
No, I want to be clear. I do not respect the SEC. I do not respect them.
But you're abiding by the settlement, aren't you?
Because I respect the justice system.
Don't forget to click that subscribe button to become a member of the Bit Squad. For the month of December, we're giving away a Nano Ledger S sponsored by Nimic. Make sure you guys like and comment on all of our videos in December to get the maximum number of entries. Hello, Bit Squad. What is up? Hope you guys are doing well. I hope you guys enjoyed that clip from the beginning of the video. That was from an interview with Elon Musk on 60 Minutes. And he said a lot of very interesting things. In the interview, he talked about his role with Twitter and about how he has been limited on what he can tweet by the SEC. And then as you see in the clip there, he basically tells the SEC that he does not respect them. And to me, you know, I posed this question on Twitter. What is the largest gang in the United States? And it's obviously the government. The government is the largest gang. They do what they want. They make rules when they want to. However, a lot of the rules in the United States and the laws are actually pushed by lobbyists. And then that money coming into the government is what kind of allows them to make the certain decisions that they make. It's not that they are for the goodwill of the people as they would like for you to think. So for Elon Musk to say that, I thought it was very ballsy. And, you know, we talked about last week with John McAfee, how he's kind of the same way. They're totally opposite people. And obviously, Elon Musk also talked about in the interview about his pot smoking incident on the Joe Rogan show and about how he's never smoked anything in his whole life. And that should have been obvious by watching that clip. And then you got John McAfee, who is a very known drug user, is used probably every drug there is out there. But still, they're both two people that are fighting for freedom for us, I believe. I believe that they are wanting us to flee from the government oppression that we have seen in our country and across the world. We're seeing part of this in France happen right now with the riots going on there. So I don't know. Things like this just make me think that we are very close to a revolution. And I think blockchain and cryptocurrency are going to play a big role in that. So speaking about the SEC, we did have one of the commissioners who came out and said that ICOs are effective when laws are followed. Now, yes, I just talked about how I don't like the SEC and the way that the government, harasses people. However, now I'm doing a story about something that an SEC commissioner said, but it's news, so we got to talk about it. And the interesting thing that came out of this article was, in here, he does not say anything about the ICOs are negative. He actually says they're a great way for people to raise money. What we've seen, though, is that with influencers like DJ Khaled and Floyd Mayweather not disclosing that they were paid for ICOs, we've seen the way that ICOs have been raising money in the past has been very scandalous. But I think in the future, now that we kind of have a roadmap laid out about where, you know, crypto is going to go and ICOs are going to go, then I think it makes sense that in the future, they can be even more effective. We saw Telegram do a huge fundraiser for their token, and it was very successful, the second biggest one of this year next to EOS. So I think that with this roadmap of the rules to follow, I think ICOs can be more successful than ever. We actually had a story also coming out of China that they're going to ban security tokens. Everybody seems to think that security tokens are the future, and I've been telling everybody for a while to, whoa, hold your horses on that. I don't think that that is necessarily going to be the case. I certainly don't think it's going to be the case for 2019. I think that ICOs are going to be finding more effective ways to raise money, and I still think we're going to have a lot in the future. So a quick look at the markets. We do have Bitcoin right now at $34.91. It's been bouncing back and forth between $34 and $36 all day. Where's it going to go? I don't know. Some people are starting to talk about how bullish, there may be bullish reversals coming in right now. I don't know. I'm not a TA guy. I can't say it for sure. A lot of people are also thinking we're going to go down. At the end of the video, we're going to talk about Bobby Lee's prediction and why that actually may be something that we might see, what he says is going to come to pass. So you guys make sure to stay tuned for that. But the total market cap right now is coming in at $110 billion, Bitcoin dominance at 54.8%. So we got Coinbase doing what they're calling the 12 days of Coinbase. I think they stole my idea of the 12 days of Cryptomas, which we have coming up very soon. Basically, they're going to have an announcement every day for the next 12 days. The first one is already hit. It's WeGift. It's basically a way to take your crypto on Coinbase and turn it into e-gift cards for things like Uber, Nike, and more. So we'll just have to see what the remaining days are going to consist of with their announcements. Man, wouldn't it be something if maybe somehow XRP got on Coinbase? Maybe that was the 12th announcement. They did say that some of the announcements are going to be things listed on Coinbase. So we've already seen four smaller projects, Decentraland, Civic, and then the other two are slipping my mind right now. But we've seen four projects that just got on Coinbase already that were on that greater list of, I think it was 30 to 40 that they were looking into. So that means that probably one of these is going to get announced is going to be something that was on that list that we've already seen. So who knows? Could it be XRP? I don't know. We'll just have to wait and see. But we have 12 days. Probably going to be two or three listings at least in there, I would imagine. So definitely something to keep out for. So then we have this story. Crypto bear market has led $15 billion Bitmain to lay off employees. So Bitmain has been struggling a little bit lately. Of course, obviously mining operations across the world have also been struggling. But the thing I thought was very interesting in this article was not actually that they laid off 15%. Coinbase laid off 3% of its workforce this October. And to be honest, what this tells me is that this bear market is going on longer than even more so than some of the bigger companies could foresee. But someone who actually knew when the top was Charlie Lee. We saw from his tweet that he had last year in December. He said, oh, if you can't handle Litecoin falling to $20, then you know you don't need to be in crypto. You need to be able to stomach those. And everybody thought that prediction was absolutely ridiculous. However, now his brother, Bobby Lee, not the guy from Mad TV and not related to Tom Lee, who's the other Bitcoin bull, but Bobby Lee says that he believes that in 2019, in January, we will hit $2,500, which I've told you guys, I believe that's my target for the bottom. If we haven't already bottomed, $2,500 is about as low as I can see it going. That would match the biggest crash of Bitcoin in the past. But what he says is very crucial. It's January 2019, the price could be at $2,500. But then he says by December 2021, the price could be $333,000. Now, basically, he says that we would start moving parabolic near the end of December 2021, and the price just would shoot way, way up. He says it's basically math. This is what the history seems to indicate. And what I would say to this is that why not? It sounded ridiculous the first time I saw it to say $333,000 by December of 2021. However, when you look back at Charlie Lee's statement in the bull market last year, how ridiculous that sounded, because it did sound ridiculous at the time. And now this sounds ridiculous from $2,500 all the way to $333,000 in 2 years. It sounds ridiculous. But I think at a time like this, we got to realize there are some people that have been in this game for a long time, and they may understand the larger patterns of crypto better than even your day traders do, or even your better day traders. The people that can look at the overall history of Bitcoin, take all that into consideration, and make predictions like this. So because of Charlie Lee's prediction last year, you have to wonder how much did Bobby Lee's way of thinking about crypto and Charlie Lee's way of thinking of crypto, how did they combine? How did they merge? And maybe together they had, they came up with the idea that it would drop back down to $20. They probably have access to a lot of the same information. And I don't know, was Bobby Lee really the one who was pushing that to Charlie Lee? Or maybe vice versa. Maybe Charlie Lee is pushing this to Bobby Lee. It's just really hard to know. But they are siblings, and so they do share a lot of information, I'm sure. And in my opinion, the fact that Charlie Lee has credibility from last year, from that, it wasn't necessarily a prediction, but from his tweet, and this year to what Bobby Lee is saying, I think I give this one a lot of credibility. Now, of course, they are predictions, so there's any number of things that could happen between now and then, but I'm going to take this one much more serious than I'm going to take random Joe Blow that's some kind of bull that just wants to say what his price is. So I think it's a very interesting article. You guys should check it out. But I guess this brings me to the question I want to ask you guys. What would you guys rather have? Would you guys be willing to sit through a bull or through a bear market for another 2 years and get those kind of gains? Or would you rather in the short term go back up? Let's say we get back to 10,000 by January and then maybe we top out at 60,000, but we do it next year. We don't have to wait. Which would you guys rather have? Would you rather have the short-term bull or the long-term bullish projection come true?
You must choose. But choose wisely.
I don't know. I think for me, obviously, that number looks really tasty at $333,000. But it also, it would also be nice to get some gains over this next year. But I would definitely say I would rather take that, third of $1 million over what I think it would probably go on a run if we started right now, which would be about, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000. So you guys, let me know what you think. Drop me a comment down below, and we'll talk to you guys later. BitBoy out.